This is Export Like a Boss, the podcast for those on the front lines of international business and trade. Succeed in business on a global scale. The planet is your market. Here is your host, Alberto Rodriguez Baez.
Welcome to Export Like a Boss. Today's guest is Michael Rosales, Senior International Trade Specialist with the U.S. Commercial Service. If you are not familiar with the U.S. Commercial Service resources and assistance, stay tuned. The U.S. Commercial Service is an amazing organization that provides invaluable services to exporters. I have used their services many times and always received great assistance. Without further ado, here is Michael Rosales, Senior International Trade Specialist with the U.S. Commercial Service. Michael, good morning.
Good morning, Alberto.
Can you please tell us a little bit about the U.S. Commercial Service?
Sure. The U.S. Commercial Service is a federal agency that is here to help U.S. companies sell and export their products, services, technology worldwide through the support of the consulates and embassies throughout the world. Our main focus is to help companies that have at least 51% U.S. content.
And is that for only exporters or importers as well?
It's only for exporters. Importers, we have partner agencies like the International Trade Center at UTSA that can help with those questions related to imports.
Michael, can you tell us how many people work in your office in San Antonio and how about in other offices around the country?
In San Antonio, we have three people total, myself, my colleague, Oscar Magana, and our director, Daniel Rodriguez. We actually cover territory from San Marcos all the way to the border and then Corpus del Rio. So it's a pretty big part of South Texas that we cover. We have an additional 99 other offices throughout the U.S., and we're also present in 70 countries throughout the world. And I think roughly we have a little bit over 300 employees total throughout the world.
How many offices do you have in Texas?
So we have five offices. We have San Antonio, Houston, Dallas, Austin, and El Paso. And they're all territory-specific, so we cover the whole state of Texas.
If a company is interested in contacting your office in San Antonio or the offices in other parts of Texas or in other states, where can they find the information?
One of the ways they can find this information is if they go to export.gov and they click on the blue banner where it says domestic offices. Click on that button and it'll give them a box where they can insert their zip code. Once they insert their zip code, they hit enter and then it'll take them to the location nearest to them. But the easiest way is whoever's listening to this now, they can contact me at 210-472-4020 and I'd be happy to give them the correct information and the industry specialist that will be helping them in their territory.
What are the services that your organization provides to American exporters?
At the very least, we offer free export counseling for U.S. companies trying to export their products all over the world. Whatever destination they're looking at, we usually bring in our colleagues in the market that are focused on their specific sector. And so that's for free. We do that every day. Some of the services that we do offer that have a fee are the International Partner Search, the Gold Key, and the International Company Profile.
Let's switch to some specific examples. Can you tell us about a couple of examples of companies that have used your organization's services? What were their challenges, how they were assisted by your organization, and what were some of the results?
There's a few examples I can give. One of the examples is a maintenance repair operating company that was trying to find representatives throughout the world. And so what we were able to do was, you know, they've gone to trade shows throughout the world. They've been contacted from numerous people throughout the world, and they just didn't know who these people were. And so they reached out to us. We've taken that information, went back to the specific market where the inquiry came from, and we actually contracted an international company profile where the U.S. Embassy will take that information, reach out to the foreign target company, and ask them a list of questions, get information about board of directors, any legal challenges. They'll talk to associations within the country to find out What is their ways of doing business? Are they reputable? Do they have good standing? Then the embassy will visit their location, ask them the questions, and also give a report where they will either give the recommendation for or recommendation against working with this company. And so this company is contracted probably over 100 of these ICPs throughout the world in over, you know, I would say maybe about 8 years. And they've been able to establish really good relationships. They've been able to renew these relationships. And especially when you're doing business overseas, when you get into a relationship with a company, you want to find the best partner, because when it comes to international business, if there is a divorce, per se, where you no longer work with this company, sometimes there could be some hardships where the company is not really working with you and dissolving that relationship. And you want to do your best due diligence so that you don't have to be in that situation. There are some other examples I can give. Sometimes companies look at the big markets and they see an opportunity as the size of the market. You know, they know, you know, in relation to the U.S., this market is twice as big as far as size, and they may have good potential. Well, a lot of times we bring in our partners like the International Trade Center, and we kind of work with this client to say, look, what are your goals? What are you trying to do? Let's do some market research on the best buyers for your product. Then we give them a report. Well, the International Trade Center will give the report on the top markets purchasing their product based on their Schedule B. And then we can take those markets and introduce this U.S. exporter to my colleagues at the embassy. And we set up a conference call. We find out if, in fact, this market is a good market for their product. What are some limitations? What are some expectations? What are some trends right now? And a lot of times there's free market research available through the U.S. Embassy via the country commercial guides that are created and updated every year by the embassy staff. So we look at it from what can we do in relation to helping them with the services that we have available. And then we also look at it from the non-fee-based services where, you know, we can take information from them, kind of sit at the table, look at what their marketing strategy is or their global strategy is, and try and help them develop so that they can go from point A to point B without any hiccups along the way, but where we can also add value and we don't charge the company anything.
Can you tell us a little bit more about what are the country commercial guides?
Sure. The country commercial guides are reports that are created every year by the U.S. Embassy staff. So it talks about best prospects, current government climate, when you're traveling over there, what to look for as far as you prepare for your international business travel. It gives information about how to set up distribution channels, how to establish a distributor, what are, you know, the best ways to enter via e-commerce. Just a really good snapshot of the market so that this is basically your due diligence when you're looking at a market. You want to get as much information as possible, well, the least cost available, which is free, and we can give that to you. And so we want to work with you to make the best steps as you're proceeding to any market.
And there are so many amazing services that your organization provides. So a couple of the services that you mentioned, the Goalkey service and the international company profile, are amazing services that I personally have used. Can you explain a little bit more about what they are and costs associated with those specific services?
Sure. So there's three services. There's the International Partner Search, the Gold Key, and the International Company Profile. And so I'll start with the International Partner Search. This is where the U.S. exporter would say, I'm interested in X market, and I want to sell to this market. A lot of times, U.S. exporters think of sales as selling to the end user. But the most beneficial way of doing business is to work with a distributor that can do the work for you in that market and work those angles, work those leads, and they're buying directly from you. And so what we do is we try and connect U.S. exporters with potential distributors, reps, agents worldwide, as well as trying to help them sell to the foreign government. So the International Partner Search is basically where we'll set up a conference call with the sector-specific specialist there in that market. The specialist will get as much information about the company so that when they make these calls to these companies that are interested in either adding this product to their current existing product line or being a rep in that market, they'll take this information and basically be your marketing person when they're promoting your product in that market. they'll take the information and they'll get us a list of maybe, and depends on the sector and the market, because some markets have really good potential, some markets may not have as much potential, but the specialists will let us know. And so basically they'll give us a list of the point of contact within that company, which is usually the decision maker or the buyer. They'll give us phone numbers, emails, and level of interest. And so usually I would say roughly it's between 5 to 8, but they're really good distributors. It could be more, and again, it just depends on the sector and the market. So that's what the international partner search is. And for the service, it costs $600 for a small, medium enterprise. So any company with under 500 employees would pay $600 per list per country. So if you're looking at 3 markets, it would be 600 times 3. The other offer that we provide is a first-time use service. So if a company is interested in, you know, never worked with the commercial service, this is the first time they're contracting the service, the service would actually be $350 for the first-time use. After that, it would jump to the $600 range until you have over 500 employees for your company. The second service is the Gold Key service, where it's an extension of the international partner search, except the U.S. exporter is going to this foreign destination, and the U.S. Embassy is setting up pre-screen meetings with potential buyers or potential reps that are interested in doing business with you. So when you go to this foreign market, you will be with U.S. Embassy representative that speaks the local language, knows the culture, and will be with you during these meetings. You'll also be able to either invite the target company to the U.S. Embassy for the meeting, or you and the specialist will go to their facility and visit with this company at their location. Usually it's between 4 to 6 appointments per day, and the meetings depend based on the logistics. You know, you can have a meeting on one side of town, and it may take you an hour and a half to get to the other side of town. So usually we try and find the best fit for the U.S. company, and we try and give them as much information prior to the meeting as well. So usually in the middle of the delivery date, which sometimes can be 3 months, because, you know, these U.S. embassies are getting contacted by over 100 offices in the U.S. with U.S. manufacturers, U.S. exporters that are wanting their service. So a lot of times it's a 3-month lead, but they'll give us, in the middle of that time, they'll give us a layout of who's interested, what companies are, and kind of give them direction of where this Gold Key is going. So for the Gold Key service, it costs $700. And so if it was your first time use for a service with a commercial service, it would be $350 as well. The last service is the international company profile, where a U.S. company is interested in doing business in a foreign market. Maybe they have a potential rep that they've been approached by via, you know, email or at a trade show or someone that they found online. And so what they want to do is the U.S. embassy will take that information, reach out to this foreign target, and ask them a list of questions, find out information about their doing business, references, legal situations. They'll find out who the board of directors are. They'll also visit with them on site, and they'll also give the recommendations. And that service also costs $600. And again, if it's the first time use of the service for the commercial service, it would be $350. And so these are the general services that we offer. What I like to do personally is I like to sit down with the company and ask them, look, we do sell services, but our goal is to help you sell. So what we want to do is, have there been any companies that have reached out to you in the past wanting to buy from you in recently that you maybe have overlooked and are in foreign markets? Or is there somebody that you're actively pursuing, or are there connections that you have to certain markets that we can kind of work? A lot of times, through a simple email of information, we can reach out to our colleagues, and our colleagues are interested in helping the U.S. company, so they can take whatever information is available, and we can work together to try and see if there's something already in process that we can work with before we move on forward with the service. Initially, if you're looking at it from a cost situation, you know, $350, having the U.S. embassy knock on doors for you in a foreign market and pitching your product to potential buyers is a steal, in the sense of, you know, if I were to come back to my office and Google search, you know, potential buyers, I'd find out, sometimes it's even hard to find out who that person is that's the decision maker. And then trying to get through the gatekeeper and then trying to find out who the buyer is can take a long time. And so this time that you're taking could be, you know, months or multiple months. But with the commercial service, we can kind of usually get that taken care of pretty quick. I know I mentioned our lead time can be up to 3 months, but it just depends on the schedule and the availability of the trade specialist. But as Alberto, as you know, sometimes the more you work with the commercial service, now you have a friend over there that's really interested in the well-being of your company. So a lot of times, you know, as they get to know you, they start doing things for free in the sense of, you know, making an introduction for you or giving a recommendation that you maybe never thought of. And so it's really good about seeing the U.S. Commercial Service as your global partner as we're trying to help you penetrate these markets through people that are on the ground. They're working on your best interest.
Absolutely. And I always found your office in San Antonio being tremendously responsive, and your colleagues in the foreign offices around the world being tremendously excited about helping and thinking about the ways that they could help me and or all their clients to succeed in that country, providing all kind of insights, suggestions. And the people that staff those offices abroad, they are industry specialists. Michael, can you tell us a little bit more about the specialists that work at the U.S. Commercial Service offices abroad?
We cover all sectors. We cover everything from aerospace, consumer goods, automotive, manufacturing, telecom, healthcare, medical equipment, services. It could be marketing services or e-commerce. We cover everything, anything and everything. And so, you know, here in the U.S., I consider us as, you know, jack of all trades, masters of none, because our colleagues overseas are the masters of those trades within their respective markets. They've been working those sectors and those angles, and they also know the importers that are interested in purchasing your product. So it's really a connection of support that the federal government offers to U.S. companies that these companies do not know that are really available. You know, and it's working with our partners like the International Trade Center, you know, in tandem, and even some of our logistics providers, where we try and give this dream team approach to these U.S. manufacturers or U.S. exporters, because sometimes they need a Rolodex of companies or support that they can reach out to that maybe have experience in doing business a certain way that maybe they haven't had that experience yet. And so at the end of the day, we really want to just help these companies grow and be successful. And we also, you know, at the end of the day, it's providing quality jobs, it's providing better quality life for their families and for their employees' families, and it's really just creating a better economy for the U.S. This is probably a good reminder for you to reach out to our colleagues that are in your territory, because there's events from their sector-specific webinars. There's some that charge. There's some that are free. We have trade missions going on all the time. We have what's called the Discover Global Markets, where you actually help companies in connecting them with our overseas colleagues that come to the U.S. At times, we have about 20 trade specialists per event, per Discover Global Markets. So, for example, I'm working on one right now that's September 13th through the 15th in Seattle, Washington, and it's Discover Global Markets Healthcare Connections. And so this one is specifically going to be targeting helping U.S. Healthcare, medical devices, anything related to the healthcare industry that is being made here in the U.S., we're trying to help them export and sell throughout the world. So if you want more information on that, you can reach out to me again, 210-472-4020. We also have another one coming up related to advanced manufacturing in Scottsdale, February of 2017. And this is going to be mostly targeted for the inputs, anybody that manufactures components for the manufacturing industry. It's going to be a really great event. And if you have any questions, I can help you with that as well. But these two events are really designed to help people and companies in these sectors and help them identify what are the opportunities for me in foreign markets. And during the show, like I mentioned, our colleagues that are going to be there from overseas, they're there to set up one-on-one appointments so that they can talk to these U.S. companies, find out what their technologies are, find out what their questions are, and really take that next step in helping them get into a market that they're trying to penetrate.
I've been to a couple of these events, and they are amazing. The level of networking, assistance, and introductions are priceless. So, Michael...
And Alberto, just to add, you know, if whoever's listening to this this podcast, you know, Alberto and I, you know, we treat each other like family, and anybody on this podcast is like family. So, usually if you're interested in any of this information, I'm going to be at the one at Scottsdale and I'm going to be at the one in Seattle, and I'll be happy to make that event as enjoyable for you as possible.
And talking about it, you were not long ago at a trade show assisting companies and making them feel like family. So can you tell us a little bit about your trip?
Sure. So I was in Hanover, Germany, at the end of April. And so we took a delegation of about 456 companies to Germany. Some were economic development organizations there to bring foreign companies to attract and help them set up in the U.S. and help create jobs and sustain jobs here. The other half was there so that they can sell their products to Germany, but also through the region, through the European Union. This trade fair was enormous. I mean, there was like 17 pavilions. There was so many people walking around. It was everything and anything. And so mainly targeting related to manufacturing. So it could be from the industrial supply side to the inputs, whether it's raw product, finished product, even to robotics. I mean, it was also research driven. There was research, a research pavilion where they were sharing about, you know, the up and coming, you know, trends and inventions coming up that are being displayed throughout the world. But our goal was really to help these companies. You know, the United States was a country partner this year that was selected, and so President Obama was there as well as Secretary Pritzker, and so we needed, you know, to have a good representation of U.S. companies, U.S. technology, and I think we did that. And I think, you know, when we came back, a lot of the companies either have been on foreign trade shows or this was their first one, and a lot of them that we're still talking to now, they are just excited about doing business internationally, and they know that they have us overseas to help them out. A lot of our colleagues were able to go to the show and offer support from markets all over the world because they were able to bring in foreign delegations that were buyers for U.S. product, as well as being able to consult some of the U.S. companies that were there on site. So at the end of the day, it was really a great experience for the U.S. It was a great experience for U.S. exporters, and I feel it helped us really see what's out there and see where we are on the level playing field. And I feel that the U.S. as a whole has a competitive advantage, especially with the quality of products that are made here.
Having attended so many international trade shows, it can be very intimidating just being there by yourself. You don't know anybody. You are there just one of many, many companies exhibiting at these massive trade shows, like, for example, in Europe, in Germany. But also, I attended events where I had the support of the U.S. Commercial Service, and it makes a tremendous difference. Michael, the companies that you were with, what kind of assistance were you able to provide to them?
Sure. So it was you know, like you mentioned, Alberto, there's a ton of companies there. You're in a booth and you're hoping that business comes your way. And so with Hanover, Mesa, what the U.S. Commercial Service decided to do was we decided to provide value-added services where we would help companies, where we would assign a client relationship manager to each company. Like, for example, I was a client relationship manager, and I had about 23 companies that I oversaw that were there. And so our goal was to help them from everything from opening ceremony, giving them information about hotels, helping them with the logistics, helping them process product and get product from the U.S. to Hanover to the trade show effectively so that it's there when they arrive. So basically the logistics. We also were able to provide them with guided tours. So we worked with Hanover Mesa. There were people that had signed up for, you know, basically wanting to learn about U.S. technology and wanting to get tours from some of the companies that were there. And so the company that I helped were in Hall 4 and Hall 6. And so, you know, every day at a certain time, Hanover Mesa would bring, you know, 4 to 10 potential buyers, reps, agents through the hall, and we reached out to the people that were going to be in the hall and asked them if they were interested in presenting, and a lot of them did. And so at any given time, two companies gave a presentation to the audience that was provided by Hanover Mesa. And so a lot of times what we did was we would walk back with them to drop off their headsets because, you know, some of these people either speak English or don't speak English. And so as we returned back to them to drop off their headsets, we actually invited them back to continue the dialogue. You know, some of them had questions, and we only had a 10-minute slot to where each company provided like a 5-minute presentation. But we really wanted to bring them back so they could touch the product, feel the product, ask questions, and really get to build a friendship and a relationship on site. That was one of the services we offered. We also offered where the U.S. company would submit their information on an online platform that was available to the Hanover Messe participants, where they could go in directly into the portal, sign up, and schedule meetings with U.S. Exporters. And so that was really good, too, because this was a lot of work that was done prior to the show. So that was in place. You know, a lot of times, too, you know, these companies don't know each other, and they're from different parts of the U.S., and sometimes there can be an application from one company that needs one from another. And so a lot of times they were doing business and trying to make a better U.S. product with the technology that was available at the show. You know, the list goes on, but at the end of the day, when you get there on Monday and you see the traffic that's available and moving through the floor, and you see the clients and how they're responding to the people that are walking the floor, you always want them to have a better time. You know, a better time means more business, more traffic. And so our goal was working with our colleagues, finding out if there was anybody else interested in particular products, particular technologies, and we would bring those potential buyers and reps to the booth area. And, you know, it was really interesting to see where they were on Monday and where they were on Friday. And Friday, you know, we basically were family. You know, we were all watching out for each other. We were sending leads to each other. You know, it was great. So at the end of the day, we really want to just help companies succeed in international markets.
Great. And again, it is incredibly important that anyone that is thinking about going to an international trade show reaches out to the U.S. Commercial Service office first in their city to see what kind of assistance they are providing for that event, or also to get in touch with the specialists in the country where the trade show is going to take place. So, Michael, we talk a little bit about the organization, the U.S. Commercial Service organization. We talked a little bit about the services. Let's switch to the last segment of this show, and I want to ask you a little bit about your advice for people that are listening to the show, that are interested in exporting, or that are already exporting. So I want to ask you a few questions about your experience in international business. Michael, what are some of the most common mistakes you see new exporters make?
They're not so much mistakes, they're like learning lessons, and I see that a lot of times companies are not aware of what's available. And, you know, for example, the U.S. Commercial Service and the International Trade Center, like the Small Business Administration, the Minority Development Agency, we're all there to help the companies. We just need to know what they're looking for. And a lot of times, it's just doing their due diligence. You know, they look at a market and they say, I want to export here. A lot of times it could be because their friend lives there, a family member lives there, or it just is appealing to them, or maybe they visited that location earlier in their life and they always wanted to come back. But at the end of the day, we need to make an educated leap of faith. And so I feel like sometimes the U.S. company has to do their homework. And in doing their homework, they need to reach out to support agencies like us, where we have the market research, we have the tools, we have the expertise, we have people on the ground in those markets who can really give them insight of how to best approach this market and if the market's even, you know, a good fit for them. Because we want to be able to give the exporter the best insight, the most up-to-date information, and a lot of times that can be handled by a free conference call with our colleagues overseas in that market as well.
How about companies that want to start doing international sales?
I think the first thing to look at is, how are you selling your product domestically? What's worked and what hasn't worked? Because when you take a leap into the international markets, it's a different ballgame. And it's kind of like, you know, when you hear, like in the NBA or the NFL, you hear, you know, people that are in college and they talk about the pros, or like everything's moving at a faster speed. And that's kind of what's happening in international business. These people overseas have been doing business, you know, with neighboring markets for a long time. And so a lot of times they have specific questions that have specific questions about volume, quality, Incoterms, logistics, letters of credit, how to get paid or how they can pay you. And so I think the best approach is really just to kind of have a snapshot of what your to-do list is. And we can help with that. International Trade Center can help with that. We want to make sure that whenever you knock on that door overseas, that you're the best prepared person in doing business with that market.
Is there a situation that you have faced or a situation you have been part of in which you definitely thought, man, we are not in Kansas anymore? This is not the same as doing business in the United States.
It's kind of funny. It's not related to business, but I think it's a cultural perspective. And I was able to travel to Japan a few years back with Ms. Shirani, who actually was the reason that San Antonio was able to bring Toyota manufacturing to San Antonio. And so we were over there visiting Kumamoto City, Nagoya, Toyota City, and Tokyo. And in one of the locations we traveled in, I went to, you know, just like everybody, you know, we go to the bathroom. And I noticed that the commodes were on the floor. And it made me think, man, I'm not in Kansas anymore. You know, like, I'm not in the U.S. This is kind of different for me, but it's a unique example that I want to give, because on the flip side of that coin, we're all the same. We in the U.S. have just the same needs as people in Asia, in the Middle East, in Europe, in Latin America. We all have family. We all have, you know, concerns. We all have, at the end of the day, we all leave our jobs and take care of our families. And there's so many things that are parts of our life that are really, really linked to doing business. You know, I mean, business is based on trends, you know, the trends of a market, you know, the high seasons and low seasons, you know, and all those seasons are based on consumers and what they do. And so at the end of the day, the bathroom situation in Japan made me realize that we're all the same. And when we're looking at business, we have to look at it as these people are the same as us. You know, we have to also respect the culture. We should find out what the do's and the do nots are before we visit a market. And again, that can be given to you via the country commercial guide, or even in talking with our colleagues overseas through our free conference calls that we can set up. But, you know, it all comes back to doing your homework. You know, if you have your homework done, you know what to expect. You're not going to really know what to expect until you land and walk off that plane in that foreign market. But if you have at least an idea of, these people want to do business with me and I want to do business with them, and we want to create a friendship and a business relationship, then you can't go wrong.
Great, and thank you for bringing that human perspective into these business issues. That was a very, very good insight. Do you have any advice for people that are about to travel to visit potential or current clients in other countries?
You know, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but I mean, I find so much value in this. Is, you know, set up a conference call with the colleagues overseas. Let them know you'll be traveling over there. Let them know who you'll be meeting with, because they may already have insight to those companies. I would even, you know, have some print collateral material in the native language, so that when you give that information during your business meetings, those people can read it and they can see exactly what you're saying, instead of assuming that their English is, you know, up to par with yours. The other thing is, if you have a collateral piece, you can also share with our colleagues. You can maybe do just a quick scan to make sure that the language is what it is in that market. It may be best taken if you give it in the local dialect. The other thing that I'd recommend is, you know, in talking with the overseas specialist, they may be able to share with you some of the safer areas of town. You know, maybe you recommend some hotels that are maybe close to the embassy. In the event if something were to happen, you are in close proximity and that they are aware that you are in country and they can reach out to you or even look for you. There is a, you know, a natural disaster or something like that. The other thing I'd recommend is visit with our colleagues at the embassy. Pitch your product to them. Tell them, this is what I do. This is what, you know, I just want to share with you. This is my product, my technology, and I'm interested in selling to the market. A lot of times, face-to-face is worth so much more than an email or a phone call. I think in international business, we kind of are lax because we can do Skype, we can do conference calls, we can send emails. But at the end of the day, it really comes down to friendships, you know, and that's how business is done, is through the friendships and the fact that these people or you can trust somebody else and they can trust you.
Thank you very much for the advice. That is very eye-opening for people that are thinking about going to other countries to visit potential clients. And personally, when I started doing what you just mentioned, calling in advance the U.S. Commercial Service office in the country, talking to the specialist, meeting the specialist in country, it made a tremendous difference in the effectiveness of the trip, in the quality of my meetings, and all around was a total difference between going all by myself and having these conference calls and meetings with the U.S. Commercial Service specialist in that country.
Our goal is your success, the company's success. We're not in it for ourselves. We are here to help any U.S. exporter that's trying to sell the product. But at the end of the day, we are happy and we feel accomplished when we help the U.S. company sell. And so, just like you mentioned, you know, going overseas, you're able to meet with them in person and talk with them. You know, it's kind of like if you're in the States and you have a cousin in another state and you're traveling and you just want somebody that you know in case something happens, or you, God forbid, there's an emergency. But if there's ever something that you need, we are that contact in that foreign market to help you. Yeah, and the best thing is it's free. I mean, we are paid by the taxes paid by the U.S. companies that are here in the U.S. So you're already paying for our support. You just have to take advantage of it.
When I visited the U.S. Commercial Service offices abroad and met with the specialists, they are always so helpful, so excited to assist the American exporter to be successful in that country, and always have done an amazing job, tremendously professional, and always with a great attitude. Michael, do you have any parting words before we start wrapping up?
Just as a reminder, anybody listening to this podcast, feel free to call me at 210-472-4020. And if I could give any word of advice, I would say, you know, in relation to exporting or any business really, you know, take a step back and think outside the box. You know, there's a lot of ways that to do business, whether it's domestically or overseas, but take a step back. And even share your ideas with somebody. You know, a lot of times we keep these ideas to ourselves and we either act on them or we don't. But sometimes that information is vital to the expansion of your company. And if you look outside the box, see where you can connect the dots, see what dots are out there that you can connect as well and bring in to this idea, the better your company will be.
Thank you very much. And we will include all the links to the U.S. Commercial Service, Michael's information, the other organizations that Michael mentioned throughout the show. We will include all those links in the episode's notes and will be available in the website. So, Michael, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate your friendship. And as you said, we are like family.
All right, thanks so much.
I want to thank again Michael Rosales for taking the time to be with us. If you want to find the U.S. Commercial Service office in your state and learn more about their services, go to the episode's notes on our website, exportlikeaboss.com. There you'll find the link to the U.S. Commercial Service offices directory and the services menu. That's it for today. Let us know what you thought about this episode. We would love to hear from you. You can tweet us. Our handle is @exportlikeaboss. And you can also contact us via email at podcast@exportlikeaboss.com. And remember, the planet is your market. Export like a boss.
You've been listening to Export Like a Boss, the podcast for those on the front lines of international business and trade. For past episodes and more information, visit us at exportlikeaboss.com or subscribe on iTunes.